Shakhriyar Mamedyarov is known for his ferocious attacking style and beautiful sacrifices, but in this video we will be seeing his game from the second round of Gibraltar Masters, where he showed some beautiful, extremely fine endgame technique. This also proves that most of the top players can play any type of position equally well. Let's check out the game Mamedyarov vs Gordon from the second round of Gibraltar Masters 2020. The game started with d4, knight f6, c4, e6, knight f3, d5, knight c3, bishop b4, the Ragusan defense, bishop g5, h6, bishop into f6, queen into f6, and now e3. There are a lot of other variations which white can play against the Ragusan defense here. One of my favorites has always been queen f4 check, knight c6, and now c into d5, e into d5, and now just e3. The plans here for white is quite simple. White just wants to play bishop e2, short castles, and then bring the f rook to c1, play a3, play b4, and then try to gain activity on the queen side. Mamedyarov chose a very simple approach here. He played e3, short castles, and now simply bishop e2, d into c4, short castles. Of course, white does not want to take bishop into c4 immediately, because he can get some other opportunities to take the pawn on c4 with other pieces. So white simply completes his development by castling short, and now black goes for c5, a typical break in the center. Black should sooner or later go with the c5 break, otherwise he will have a lot of problems on the c-file, and his position will always remain passive without the break in the center with c5. So immediately black goes for the c5 break, which is completely fine. Now again, white does not want to take on c4 immediately, because after c into d4, and now no matter with what you take, let's see, if you take with the e-pawn, he is having a comfortable position, a comfortable version of the isolated queen pawn. So white goes for knight e4, creating more troubles for black. It is important to note that black has the bishop pair here, but he is back in the development. His queen side is yet to be developed, so he has to take care of his queen side development, and white should try to utilize this time in order to create problems for the black pieces. So after knight e4, queen e7. And now Mamedyarov again did not take on c5 or even c4, he played a3. The point here is that if black moves the bishop, then we can take, then white can take d into c5, and when it will be extremely difficult to protect the pawn on c4, and in fact white is clearly better here. Or he can also take knight into c5, when again black faces problem defending his pawn on c4. So the only way that black can maintain balance here is to play c into d4. Well, all this has already been played before, and I am sure that both the players are still in their opening preparations. The point here is of course that if white takes the bishop, then black goes d3 and wins the bishop back immediately, and the position is very balanced here. Or maybe even black could be slightly better, as after takes, if white decides to take the pawn, then black can take the pawn on b4 and be a pawn up. So of course white cannot take on b4. He goes for queen into d4, activating his queen. Bishop a5, the bishop had no other square, so bishop a5 is very logical. And now queen into c4. White of course did not want to take again with the bishop, because he would be hit by rook d8, and he will waste a lot of time moving the queen here and there. So he simply takes the pawn with queen into c4. Now black played bishop to d7, developing his bishop. As I said earlier, the priority for black should be to develop his queen side as quickly as possible. But it is important to note that black cannot play the natural move knight c6 here, because white has b4, hitting the bishop and gaining space on the queen side. After something natural like bishop b6, white can play b5 again, again hitting a black piece, the c6 knight here, and so he's gaining tempo, and also he's gaining space on the queen side, which is very difficult for black to handle. And in fact, black will again waste a lot of moves moving his pieces around and not getting anywhere. So it is wise for black to delay the development of the b8 knight for now and develop the bishop to d7, which is exactly what black played. And now Mamedyarov transposed into the endgame with queen into c5, knight c6. Here, in fact, there are a lot of games, there are some games, sorry, with bishop d8 as well. And again, it's more or less equal, the endgame is equal, but black still has to be quite precise in this endgame, as white has some initiative and he will try to create some problems. In the game, black played knight c6, queen into e7, knight into e7, and knight c5, hitting both the pawn on b7 and bishop on d7. Bishop goes to c6, very obvious. Knight goes to e5. So in this way, black is giving some sort of threats, and in this way, white is giving some sort of threats, and he simply wants to eliminate a bishop pair with knight into c6 here. Bishop to b6, immediately hitting the knight, because if you wait for one more move, let's say if you play something like rook fd8, white can simply take the bishop, and now you cannot take back with the knight because the b7 pawn hangs. And after b into c6, you simply end up having a very bad pawn structure on the queen side. So that is the reason why black played bishop to b6 in order to meet knight into c6 with bishop into c5, taking the other knight and achieving the opposite color bishop. In fact, it is well known that the opposite color bishops usually in the endgame usually ends up in a draw or has a lot of drawing tendencies. But in this game, we'll see how beautifully Mamedyarov manages to create some problems slowly for the opponent, and slowly, you know, he pressurizes and gains the upper hand. So after bishop into c5, Mamedyarov played knight to a5, hitting the pawn on b7, b6. So already there are some weaknesses in white, in black's position. The light squares here are weak, and he will have to watch out for those weak squares. So after b6, white moved the knight back to c4. The endgame seems completely equal, but we'll see how Mamedyarov slowly creates weaknesses, creates some problems, and gains space, and restricts opponent's pieces in order to gain an upper hand. Rook fd8, bringing the rook on the open file. Nothing can be more logical than that. In fact, okay, one important thing to note is that white is threatening b4, trapping the bishop. So rook d8 basically prepares for b4, as b4 can now be met by bishop d6. In fact, this is what happened in the game. Another option for him would have been to play knight to d5, creating the e7 square for the bishop, which is completely fine, but white would have then put pressure on the d5 knight with rook fd1 and then bishop to f3. Again, the position is more or less equal, but white always has something going for him. So in the game, black played rook f to d8, b4, attacking the bishop and gaining space on the queen side, bishop to d6. Now white cannot play, white cannot exchange knight d6 immediately, because after rook d6, the black rook is coming on d2, and if white plays rook d1, then simply rook a d8, and it will lead to a lot of exchanges. Again, this endgame is still playable, but it is quite close to a draw, I would say. So after queen c, after knight c4, rook fd8, b4, bishop d6, white does not need to take the bishop immediately. He simply plays rook a c1, trying to control the c file here. Not a d5 because again, as I said before, it might lead to the exchanges of the rooks, and white wants to maintain rooks at this point in order to create some more threats on the queen side. Knight goes to d5, very logical. In fact, now maybe white could have taken the bishop, as after rook into d6, the rooks are still on the board, which helps white in order to create some pressure here. And white could have simply played maybe something like rook c2, rook c1, rook fc1 next, and this bishop might be slightly better than the knight on d5, than the black knight on d5, because it is usually it is well known that when the pawns are on both sides of the board, usually the bishop is slightly better than the knight. So in this position, it would have been favorable for white to have to go into this endgame. But Mamedyarov has some other plans. He is completely playing against this bishop by restricting with a3 and b4, so he does not want to exchange it for now, and we'll see how he expands on the king side next. So after knight d5, he is not interested in the exchanges. He played g3. The point here is to cover the f4 square, and later white can kick the d5 knight with e4, so that he does not have the option of coming to f4. Bishop goes to f8, rook c2, intending to play rook fc1 and gaining more control on the c file. Rook c8, rook fc1, all quite logical for now. g6. So black is also placing his kingside structure ideally. e4, as was the plan of g2, g3, to play e4 and kick the d5 knight, which is very well placed in the center. Black goes knight f6, f3, defending the pawn on e4. Knight goes to d7. From here on, I think black went astray and he lost the thread of this game, as he went on a knight maneuver which basically just landed him in a worse position. A more natural way to play in this position, the correct way to play, was to go for a5 here, breaking this pawn chain, which is restricting his own bishop on f8. So a5 was logical, but even after that, of course, white will not go for b into a5, as after b into a5, the pawns will be liquidated, and taking here is simply a draw after this, and then bishop into a3. But white will go for b5, so still fixing the weakness on the b6 pawn, and which black will have to keep on defending. So b5, and after rook b8, defending the pawn, king g2, rook c8, rook d1. The endgame is objectively equal, but practically I believe that white still has the upper hand, because this knight on c4 is beautifully placed, very well placed, and it is always attacking this weakness on b6. Black can defend it comfortably, but yeah, he has to defend it, and white will always find some other ways, you know, to put pressure on black's position. So but a5 should have been played. At least it would have increased the mobility of the bishop on this diagonal. Right now it is completely closed and dominated. So in the game, black played knight to d7, king g2, a very normal move, improving the position of the king. And now here I believe that black made a serious mistake. He played the knight to b8. Well, the knight was decently placed on f6, okay, still not doing much on f6, but on b8 it is very, very bad. I guess what black wanted to do was to play the knight from from b8 to c6 and then to d4, but as we will see, white does not allow this and does not give black a single chance to activate his knight again till the end of the game, actually, from b8. So white simply goes on gaining space on the king side and arranging the pawns on the dark squares so as to limit the mobility of the f8 bishop. So white just wants to play e5, which will increase his own bishop's mobility, while limiting his opponent's f8 bishop. So after f4, rook to c7, intending to double on c5, and then maybe to play b5 and exchange all the rooks on the c5 here. One important thing to note is that black cannot play knight to c6 immediately because of the tactical shot knight into b6, and now rook into c6 when white will simply win a pawn. So rook c7 with the idea of rook c8 and b5. White of course anticipated this idea and he played knight to e5, exchanging the rooks immediately when he will be able to maintain the control on the c-file. Rook into c2. Now as we see, this knight is hopelessly placed on b8. Bishop goes to d6, kicking the knight from e5. White goes knight g4, getting tempo on this pawn. King g7. If black would have played h5, then white could have simply played knight f6 check followed by e5 with the upper hand. Black goes king g7, defending the f6 pawn as well as protecting the f6 square. e5, bishop e7. So as we see, it is important to note that how Mamedyarov has actually placed his pawns on the dark squares. So this is a very very well known thing to do, to place the pawns on the opposite color of the bishop that you own. So in this position, white has the light square bishop, so white places his pawns on the dark squares. Basically in this position, it is increasing the mobility of his own bishop and also restricting the scope of the black bishop on e7. Knight goes to f2 here. The idea is to centralize the knight with knight to e4. a5. So finally black goes for a5, but I am sure that it is too late now, as we'll see that even after black plays a5 successfully, this knight on b8 is remains a big problem, a big headache for black. So white goes rook to c7, rook d7, rook to c8, rook d8, and now he exchanges on d8 in order to distract this bishop for now. Bishop into d8, b into a5, b into a5, bishop goes to b5, a nice move, completely locking down the knight on b8. And the knight doesn't really come out till the end of the game from the fateful b8 square. Bishop goes to b5. Now there are two ways for black to play in this position. He can try to bring this knight out from d7 by moving his king closer, by bringing his king to e7, or he could take counterplay, try to take some counterplay on the king side by breaking with f6. Black chose to go for the f6 break here. If he goes for king f8 with the idea of king e7 and knight d7, white could simply play king f3, bringing his king closer. King e7, and now black wants to go knight d7, so white should go for knight g4, hitting the pawn on h6, and after h5 knight to f6, controlling the d7 square. And is obvious that again it is extremely difficult for black to bring out the knight out of this cage dominated by the b5 bishop. So it is not at all easy for black to bring the knight out. If black first goes for h5, covering the g4 square, even then after king f3, king f8, and now knight e4, king e7 and knight f6 again, black simply cannot bring the knight out. It is basically simply a transposition to the previous line which we just saw. So in the game, he went for the break on the king side with f6. White goes knight to d3, threatening to play knight to c5 and putting a lot of pressure on this pawn. Black should go for bishop b6, covering the c5 square, into f6 check, king f6. And now even white has a better pawn structure than black's on the king side. Plus this knight is always a problem. White goes for a4, fixing the pawn on a5 here. Black continues with his strategy of creating counterplay on the king side with g5, king f3, king f5, h3, bishop to c7, fg5, king into g5, knight goes to f2, king f5, h4, king f6. So both sides are kind of waiting. White is improving a bit. White is improving his king side structure a bit, but black has nothing more to do than just to wait for white's plan to get executed. So king f6, black is just playing the waiting game here. h5. This move actually surprised me a lot, because it is simply giving this g5 square for the black king, which he could have avoided by just placing the pawns on g3 and h4. But again, it is of course a question of how white can in fact create progress. But I'm sure that Mamedyarov had already started looking for some sort of mating nets, even with a limited number of pieces. So h5, allowing the g5 square to the king. But as we will see, it in fact ends up problematic for black as he went to the g5 square. So first, black played the bishop to b6, distracting the knight from f2. So after bishop b6, knight goes to g4, check, king g5, and now knight to e5. It seems that white simply wins the pawn, but after king h5, in fact, white has king to f4, when black simply cannot prevent a mate with bishop e2 or bishop e8 check, and it will simply be a mate. So black cannot take the pawn for now. He goes for bishop to c7, again attacking the knight, so that later on he could take the pawn. But white now plays knight to g6. Well, again, black cannot take the pawn on h5. Okay, this time there is no mating net, but white has this beautiful knight f4 check. White, black cannot play king g5 because knight a6 check wins the bishop. So also he cannot take bishop into f4. Well, that is the only move right now. So after bishop into f4, white is still winning. After king f4, king g6, king e5, and the plan is very, very simple: to go to c7 and collect the knight, which is just sitting there to be taken. So after king e5, if black plays king g5, king into e6, king g4, king d6, king g3, king c7, and white will simply collect this knight on b8 and come back to collect the pawn. In the meanwhile, the bishop can stop the h pawn from queening with bishop to c6, and white is simply winning in this position. So let's go back. So that is why black can still not take the pawn on h5, which he desperately wants to take. That is the reason why black played e5 here, covering the f4 square, and now intending to take on h5. But as we will see, it is in fact a mistake, and black simply ends up losing quickly after e5. The best that he could have done was to just wait with bishop to d6. The point is that now knight f4 can be made by bishop into f4, g into f4, king into h5, and now the position is in fact a draw, because after king e4, king h4, king e5, king g3, king into e6, king into f4, compared to the previous variation, now the king is very near to the b4 square, and this ends up in a draw after king d6, king h5, king c7, king e5, king b8, king d6. The black king will go to b4 and then start pushing his h pawn till h1, when the bishop will have to take on h1 with bishop c6, bishop h1, and black will eliminate white's only pawn remaining on the board with king into a4. So this would be a draw. So in this position, black would have actually waited with bishop d6, and maybe the game would have ended in a draw. But black goes for e5, covering the f4 square, and now simply intending to take on h5. The point is of course that g4 also does not work, because after e4, king into e4 and king g4, when it would be just equal and white cannot protect his pawn on h5. This is what black would have expected here, but now Mamedyarov plays the beautiful king e4. It's really nice to see how Mamedyarov finds such mating rates even with a limited number of pieces. The point is, of course, that if black takes the pawn on h5, then king f5, and there is no stopping to bishop e2 checkmate. If bishop to d6, just waiting, then white can simply take the knight, simply take the pawn on e5 with knight e5, and yeah, again, it is better for white because king to king h5 can be made by king f5 again with the same idea of bishop e2 mate. So white goes for king g4, trying to grab the g3 pawn. Knight into e5, king into g3, and now king f5 again, king h4, knight g6 check. Yeah, of course, knight g6 check, and black cannot take the pawn on h5 again because of bishop e2 mate. So it's really nice that even with limited number of pieces, he was able to find a mating net and win this endgame in a beautiful technical style. I hope that you enjoyed this beautiful technical endgame by Mamedyarov and learned a lot in the process. Let me know in the comment section below whether you liked this video or not. See you in the next video. Take care.